Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. Welcome to Mica Nigeria. So a little bit about us. Here at Mica Nigeria, our vision is to see Muslims return to the state of Islamic excellence. Some of the programs we deliver include feeding the soul, creating a safe space, economic development, leadership and competency, capacity building, encouraging positive social interaction, and promoting a passion for the deen. You can become a member of Mica Nigeria by completing a membership form, which we will share. Throughout today's lecture, we will be taking questions from the chat box. So we encourage you to utilize that for any thoughts, comments, or questions you may have. As you are all aware, the topic of today's event is how to deal with infertility. So we've entitled it Road to Parenthood, How to Deal with the Struggles of Infertility. And our excellent speaker today is Dr. Rabiu. A little bit about her. She's an obstetrician gynecologist. She earned an OND in science laboratory technology from the Polytechnic of Ibadan. In her quest for more knowledge, she went further and she attended the prestigious University of Ibadan, where she earned an MBBS in medicine. She went further on, mashallah, to obtain an MBA from the Metropolitan School of Business in London and certificate in assisted reproduction in University College London. She has a special passion and interest in preventive medicine and assisted reproductive technology. Also worthy of note is the fact that she is the medical director of Shifa Medical Center in the heart of Ikorodu. She is also a blogger on Ask Dr. Fab, I believe. Thank you very much for joining us today, Dr. Rabiu. I'll hand over to you.
You're welcome. All right. Thank you, Mariam. Happy to see you. Happy to see everybody. Thank you for joining. Let's just go straight to the point. The topic is Road to Parenthood, How to Deal with the Struggles of Infertility. As you can see, from the first picture, you can see a father, a mother holding their baby. So, Road to Parenthood, How to Deal with the Struggles of Infertility. This topic is all. We are talking about what it means to actually be parents. That means you want to have your own offspring. Then we are talking about, okay, the struggles in getting your own offspring. The struggle in saying, wow, we want to have the fruit of the womb. Okay, let's remind ourselves of what Allah says in the Quran. That's in Surah Al-Shura. That's chapter 42 of the Quran, verse 49 to 50. Now, Allah says, that's Quran, Surah Al-Shura, that's Quran 42 of the Quran, that to Allah belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. He is the one that has created the heavens and the earth. He created as he pleases, or he has created what he pleases. He grants to whom he pleases daughters and grants whom he pleases sons. Or he makes them of both sorts, male and female. Let's know that there are even some set of people we refer to as hermaphrodites. So Allah makes males, he makes females. Then he makes some not able to even have either of these genders. We call them, okay, these people are infertile, they are barren. It is he that is all knowing and ever powerful. So Allah does his wills the way he wants it. He gives some, he doesn't give some. He gives some, he takes it away from some, and he doesn't even give some at all. So we know that at different parts, at different stages of life, certain set of people can be in either or any of these categories. As you see this picture, you can see a lady seated worried. You know, they say, oh, the usual problem is usually on the woman. I'll have to define what infertility is, but before that, noteworthy is of the fact that parenthood starts from the very first time we are making our choices. You want to think about the person you want to get married to. You want to make a choice, your spouse, be it the male or the female. You want to have a good father for your unborn children. You want to have a good mother for your unborn children. So your journey, the road to parenthood, starts from when you are picking your choice. You need, it's actually a responsibility of your unborn children, your responsibility on your unborn children to have good mothers and good fathers. This is very key. It is very key, and it's so important that it cannot be overemphasized. Don't let us forget that part of the journey to parenthood too includes things like saying we screen ourselves. I don't want to have a child as a sickler, so I don't want somebody that has genotype AS to marry somebody that has genotype AS, so that they are not going to have children with SS. I want to screen the intending spouse of hepatitis, screen the person of HIV, screen him for him or her of other infectious diseases. So that or those are very, very important. Now let's go to the definition of infertility. WHO, World Health Organization, has defined infertility. Now we all hear the word infertility everywhere. Infertility, infertility, infertility. WHO, World Health Organization, has given a very concise definition, which everybody will understand, because I don't plan to mention medical jargons or teach you biology, anatomy, or physiology. Go back to the definition, yeah. Infertility can be defined, or the inability of a couple, right? A couple in the sense of man and woman, lady and gentleman. We are not talking about gay marriages, God forbid. So inability of a couple to achieve pregnancy after 12 months of regular unprotected sexual intercourse. Inability of a couple to achieve pregnancy after 12 months, 1 year, of regular, mark my words, regular unprotected sexual intercourse. Now, what do you call regular sexual intercourse? What do you term as regular? In gynecology, for the sake of the record, for the sake of what we investigate patients for when it comes to issues of infertility, we take regular sexual intercourse as at least 3 times in 7 days. So let's start thinking, okay? We are talking about husband and wife living together. We are not talking about people in distant relationships. We are talking about people that are married and they are living under the same roof and they want to achieve conception. Regular sexual intercourse for them is at least 3 times in a week. Yours can be 10, yours can be 15, yours can be unlimited, but it must be up to 3 times at least, okay? What is unprotected sexual intercourse? Of course, why should I be protecting the sexual intercourse when I'm looking for a child? So that word of unprotected sexual intercourse means they are having sexual exposure, they are having sex without any form of barrier. It's not that they are using female condom, it's not that if they are using male condom, it's not as if the woman is hiding and she's taking contraceptive pills. It's not as if she's using a particular method that her spouse is not aware of. So back to our definition, a couple has been married for 12 months. They've been having sex at least 3 times in a week. They are not using any form of barrier. And for these 12 months, 1 year, they are not achieving natural conception. They are not. The wife, the woman is not getting pregnant. That is what infertility means. Now, sometimes people call infertility subfertility. There are times that it's just a matter of adjectives or semantics. So people will say, oh, a woman is subfertile, perhaps because she has given birth before. Now she's not able to give birth again. Some Yorubas we call it a daduro, like a delay. That's the English word, like a delay. Now let's talk about the burden of infertility. I will try not to talk too much. These things are English language. It contributes to 90% of the cases we see at our gynecological clinics, okay? Typical, you see 100 women come to your clinic, 90 of them at least are due to infertility. It's a major cause of social mental disharmony in our society. It creates a lot of headache, a lot of unhappiness, a lot of sadness. Unfortunately, women bear the brunt more. It's so typical in our society. They've been married for 6 months. The family is already checking her abdomen. They go for a family function. She's saying she's off Solat. And they're like, wow, so you are still buying always pad. When will you start not buying always pad? That means when are you going to get pregnant? Some are even so forward that they can start pressing her abdomen. Yeah, when is our baby coming? Or when is our twins? When are our twins coming? It's that bad in our society. Some are even so bold that they're going to say, when are you getting pregnant now? What's happening? What's causing the delay? It might even just be 6 weeks after your marriage, when some people are still trying to even enjoy the honeymoon, in quotes. It causes a lot of marital discord. It causes low self-esteem in affected couples. They are unhappy. They go about, they see people doing naming ceremony. There are friends that got married before them, or the friends that got married after them, they've gone to their naming ceremony. Also, because our governments and even non-governmental organizations, they don't fund fertility treatment. It's a lot of financial burden on the couple that are infertile. So it affects couples economically, socially, and what have you. Also, there is a sort of social stigma that comes along with infertility. So I just finished talking about the burden of infertility for us to realize how bad it affects us. Now look at this, look at it very closely. The woman is there. She's thinking, when am I going to get pregnant? God, when? When is my abdomen, or people call it tummy, when is my abdomen going to protrude out like this? When am I carrying my twins? When am I carrying my triplets? She's thinking. She's putting her shape already in the state of a pregnant woman. And you are like, well, when will this thinking end? Every day, morning, afternoon, night, she's the one that is so bothered. She's worried. What is happening? When the messes, when she sees the stain, the red stain again in the next month, oh, this messes has come again. She'll start thinking, we have been having sex. We've been having sex. What is happening? The first thing a woman thinks in this part of the world is that she's the cause of the problem. That's a big challenge for women over here. First and foremost is she's already thinking, no, I'm the reason why we have not gotten a baby. I'm the reason why we are infertile. Yeah, it takes two to tango. Everybody knows that, all right? Now, for a woman to actually get pregnant, she needs the sperm of her husband to always be a good one. I'll explain further. So it is not just the problem of the woman. It is the problem of two. The sperm has to be there. The eggs, we call the ova, of the woman has to be there, along with other things. So it is just not a unilateral problem. It is a problem of the couple. We'll get there. Let's go. I wanted us to see this. Sorry, I know some of us don't like biology. Some people scaled through classes in biology. I was told some people don't even finish their notes in class. Some will not do the drawing. They'll just make it a walkover somehow. Mm-hmm. Now, the way God has made it, the male has their own reproductive system. As you can see, the female, they have their own reproductive system. Now, both of these systems have to be intact, connecting with the brain, connecting with all the organs that will produce babies. I'll explain as time goes on. So you can see the structure. I don't want to go too much. The testicles of the man has to be there. The penile shaft has to be there. The womb of the woman that we call the uterus has to be there. The ovaries have to be there. The opening to the ovary, the opening to the womb has to be good. The fallopian tube, those things that look like tubes, like a tunnel, they have to be good too as well. So all of these things have to be intact. The testicles, the testes, as you are saying, have to produce sperm. And when the sperms are produced, they have to pass through the penile shaft of the man, the penis of the man, for the sperm to be deposited in the vagina of the woman, for it to ascend to the womb. That's the process. Next slide. I just needed to show you that for you to understand that there's a natural process for natural conception to occur. Now, type of infertility, primary infertility, the lady has never gotten pregnant. Or perhaps the man has never been able to impregnate a woman. Okay? Like I said, it's not just the woman's problem alone. It involves the man as well. So when she has never been pregnant, or the man has never impregnated anybody before, that is what we call primary infertility. Secondary infertility is when the woman has been previously pregnant, irrespective of the duration of that pregnancy or outcome. For instance, she got pregnant, 6 weeks she had a miscarriage, or she got pregnant, 8 weeks into the pregnancy, she had something happened, she carried the pregnancy to 7 months, she had a premature baby, and the baby didn't make it, okay? So I think it's very explanatory enough. Primary, she has never been pregnant, she has never impregnated anybody before, whether it's ex-boyfriend, girlfriends, or when the days of ignorance were there. Secondary, she has been pregnant before, irrespective of the duration of her pregnancy and the outcome. She's now wanting to get pregnant. She's unable to get pregnant now. Also for the man, he might have impregnated somebody before. Oh, two ladies have gotten pregnant for him before, but they aborted the pregnancy. Now he's married, he's not able to impregnate his wife, even though he has impregnated somebody before. So let's go to the causes of infertility. Now, the causes of infertility can be due to female factors, and it can be due to male factors, all right? Now, from this intersection that you can see, the one represented with zero standing is the female. The one with a zero, with an arrow, is the man, or is the male. Usually, we always remember this, that males always gravitate towards the women. That's why there's an arrow. Mm? And the woman always stands, and the man comes to her to toast her. So that's how we use those symbols, all right? Now, one third, 30% of the causes of infertility are due to female factors. 30% are due to male factors, while another 30% are due to combined factors. You understand what I'm saying? That, okay, 30% of cases is due to the female factor. Another 30% is due to the male factor. Now, there is a combination. Oh, the man has issues, the woman has issues. Those ones contribute 30%. Now, there is a remaining 10% that we call unexplained infertility. That one is that, oh, we have looked at the woman critically. She has done investigations. We have examined her. We cannot see any reason for her infertility. We have examined the man. He has done investigations. We cannot see any reason for his infertility. Those ones, we categorize them as unexplained infertility. 10% of them are unexplained. You understand what I'm saying? So this tells you that the problem of infertility is not just the woman alone, okay? It is both the woman and the man. And they could even have combined factors, and they could even have factors that nobody knows the reason. That's why at times in our society, some people will say, is it that their blood doesn't match? They were married together for 5 years. They didn't get pregnant. But when they separated or when they divorced, immediately the woman got to another man's house, she got pregnant. Immediately another woman came to marry that woman, she got pregnant. So some of those things could explain why we say, okay, there are some unexplained causes we don't know, ranging from things like immune response or some allergies and all that. Thank you. This is just, I don't want to give us lecture. So this is something very broad. When it comes to causes of female infertility, I showed you the structure of the female reproductive organ the other time, the female reproductive tract. Now, the age of the woman is important. People that are above 35 may have issues getting pregnant. There's something we call polycystic ovarian syndrome, hormonal imbalances. You would have had all these things. There could be problems with the womb, things such as maybe there's a fibroid occupying where the baby is supposed to stay. People that have fibroids get pregnant, but sometimes there could be complications such as recurrent miscarriages. There could be ovulation problems. Some women have been told that they are not ovulating. We call it an ovulation. There are sometimes a woman has given birth before, but there were complications in that birth that is now causing her not to get pregnant again. There could be recurrent miscarriages. She's just getting pregnant and the babies are coming down. Even things like what we call resource incompatibility, people that are resource negative could have this problem. Then what we call egg reserve is about the age of the woman. The younger a woman is, the better her eggs, the more efficient her eggs. Then there could be nutritional problems, like diet problems, the woman has too much weight or has too less weight. So basically for female infertility, it could be things affecting the womb, it could be things affecting her tubes, it could be things affecting where the sperm would pass through her vagina or her cervix, and it could be things affecting her ovaries, her eggs, okay? For the males, usually there are several causes too, even things like alcohol, things like smoking, things like medical conditions like diabetes, like chronic long-standing hypertension can cause male infertility. You can see it in this pie chart. There are some that are unexplained. There are some men that their testicles, they are not descending into the scrotal sac. The two testicles might not even be in the scrotum, or one of it is not descending, one is descending. And the one that is descending might not even be producing sperm. The man could have what we call infections. There could be some sexual factors. The man has, erectile dysfunction. He cannot have erection. He cannot ejaculate. There are some things we call, I mentioned systemic diseases, diabetes, hypertension, motor cilia syndrome. There are so many medical diseases that could cause male infertility. There's what we call varicose seal, when the veins are so much swollen and they're affecting that place. The way God has made that place is such that it should be under a very cool temperature. That's why the testes are suspended out and they are in the scrotal sac. At times when we have things like varicoses, the veins are engorged, there will be some kind of warmth that will affect the way sperms are being produced. Then there could be immune system factors as well. This is what happens when a man sleeps with his wife. The sperm, he has ejaculation. The sperm is deposited in the vagina. You can see the screen. It passes through the vagina of the woman. You can see the trajectory of the sperm. That's the blue one showing the arrow. So the sperm goes, passes through the opening of the womb that we call the cervix, and it travels, pum, 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 and it goes to what we call the fallopian tube. Can you see it? It goes to the fallopian tube. Then the egg, you can see it in the ovary, gets released. That's what we call ovulation, okay? So when the egg gets released, the sperm will travel. Like I told you, the man is always going to the man, to the woman. So the sperm will go to the egg, it will get fertilized, and it will come back and stay in the womb, the lining of the womb, where the baby will grow. Now, the womb is an elastic structure. That's why you can see some women's abdomen when they are pregnant, very big. That's why a woman can carry six babies, a sextuplet. She can carry quintuplet, she can carry quadruplet. The muscle is very, very elastic. So that's the trajectory of the sperm. So all these things must be normal for conception to take place. And you can see this structure here in this green circular structure. The sperms were so many. A lot of them were coming. So it's a case of survival of the fittest. And they will come. One that has really won or has won the game will now fertilize the egg and form what we call a zygote, which forms what we call an embryo. And that embryo, when it now comes and get deposited in the womb, it starts becoming a baby that we all see. So, like I was saying, for natural conception to occur, everything must be intact. Like, I want to show us the structure of a sperm. The sperm cell is the reproductive gamete, the organ. Thank you very much. You can see it. You can see the edge of the sperm. It is called, it has what we call the acrosome, that has what we call digestive enzymes. Those enzymes are what will be able to penetrate into the egg of a woman so that a baby can be formed. Okay, that's the egg. Now there's what we call the meat piece. Some people call it the neck. And that one to also has what we call a powerhouse. It has things that has to work that we join with that of the egg to form a baby. On the edge as well, you can see it has a lot of things that we call DNA. So when we are saying they are doing paternity tests, DNA tests, we are coming back to the basis of all those things. Then you can see this long tail, okay? Some people, they say it's the flagellum for propulsion. The sperm has to be able to move, okay? If you see the other part of the diagram as well, you can see the head, the meat piece, the tail. You can see the sperm. As small as this sperm is, it is a very wonderful cell that is very, very important in reproduction. So all men on this platform, you can see how your sperm look. Now look at the normal sperm here and look at sperms that are abnormal, defective sperms. Some have two heads. That's abnormal. Imagine somebody, human being having two heads. That person is abnormal. Some don't have heads at all. Some have more than one tail. Some have a defective meat piece. Okay, some don't even have tails. Now, for a sperm to be normal, the head must be okay, the neck, the meat piece must be okay, and the tail must be okay. I decided to talk about the male part before talking about the female part. So if we have abnormal sperms, we are going to have problems. So look at this. I said for a goal to be scored, for people that like football, at times we relate it to like scoring a goal, okay? What I'm saying is for natural conception to occur. Now, you hear people say he has slow sperm counts, low sperm counts. The doctor say my sperm is low. Some are even so bad that they will tell us that the man does not even have sperm at all. There could be some, there are so many cases like that. So it's not even just about the counts of the sperm of that man. You might have the normal range of the sperm count is 20 to 200 million. You might have 200 million sperm and they are all useless. Maybe all the sperms don't have heads or they don't have tail or they don't have a neck, a meat piece. So at times it's not all about the count for men. So the count must be wonderful. It must be a very good count between 20 to 200. The sperm must be normal. That's why I showed the structure of a normal sperm. And that's what we call morphology. It must appear normal. The structure must look okay. The sperm must be able to move. That's what we call excellent motion. It must be able to move fast so that it can go and run and meet the egg through the female reproductive tract, okay? So also the egg of the woman must be of good quality. The egg must be able to get released. That's what we call ovulation. Ladies, can you hear me? Ovulation. Now, when the egg has been ovulated, when ovulation has occurred, those eggs or those released egg or the released egg must be able to pass through an open fallopian tube. I showed you the structure. It's like a pipe, okay? And when all this has happened, the womb must be normal as well to accept that baby. That's what we call implantation. So the man has done his own, the sperm has come, okay? The egg has been released by the woman. The sperm and the egg have kissed themselves, okay? They have formed what we call a zygote. It forms an embryo, and the thing will now stay gently inside the womb, okay? And it will be growing. So you can see all these sperms running to actually fertilize that egg on the right side of the screen. You can see those sperms trying to enter the egg. So like I said, the sperm, yeah. Now, I'm getting to the meat of our discussion. Okay, I just need to let you know all those things. This lecture is not for me to tell you the investigations you have to do for screening, for your infertility and all that. When we have those problems, we know the appropriate quarters to go to, your general doctor, your physician, family physician, your gynecologist, your urologist, as the case may be. Now, the struggles, my sister, my brother, it's a lot of problems when we are dealing with infertility. Some have lost hope. Some pray to God so much that they're like, God, even if the pregnancy gets aborted, if I have a miscarriage, let me just get pregnant. Let the world know that I missed my menses for once. Because some have never missed their menses for once in their life. They are so engrossed in their prayer that they even pray anything. God, let me just get pregnant, even if the pregnancy comes down. Let people even know that at least I got pregnant for 6 weeks. Because there's a lot of emotional drain. There's a lot of emotional affectation. I don't know the adjective to use. You can see the pregnancy test strip in the woman's hand. Some women have, they can be shareholders in the companies that make pregnancy test strips. They check it every time. I'm not pregnant again. They are waiting to see the two lines on the strip. It's a lot of headache. It's a lot of sadness. It's a lot of unhappiness. It's a lot of depression. Now, see my statement. She or he who wears the tight shoes knows where it ought most. I don't know how to say it. It's a Yoruba thing that I try to put it in English, okay? At times, we don't have an equivalent idiomatic expression for our Yoruba sayings, okay? What I'm saying is you cannot know how severe the sequelae of infertility is except you have witnessed it. I am talking for people trying to conceive now. Nobody can explain the hurt they feel. Is it the pressure from the in-laws? When are you going to give child? When are you going to give birth? When are you going to give our son babies? Why are you delayed? What is the problem? Even the problem might even be with the man, no? But the first thing is the woman is attacked. Friends that just got married, or people that married after you, or people that you married on the same day, or people that married before you, they got lucky. They have twins. They have boys. They have girls. You are still looking unto the Lord. You see them every day, you are unhappy. You don't even know if you are happy for them. At times, you might even be envious. But God, who have I offended? Who have I offended? What is happening? God, what have I done that you are giving me this kind of punishment? The sociocultural pressures are there. People will even give birth. They don't want to tell you, she has been trying to get pregnant for 5 years. So don't tell her that you have gotten pregnant. Don't tell her that you are doing a kiko, naming ceremony. Don't invite her to your baby showers, or she'll be crying. The social stigma is there. The woman has so many eyes on her. They start saying, maybe she's even a witch. Let's even talk about somebody that has had like 6 miscarriages. They will say, no, she's depositing all those babies in a kingdom, a witchcraft kingdom. In their society, they will say, she's cursed. Maybe mommy or daddy were cursed. So the curse is on the family. There are so many superstitious beliefs, ill beliefs about barrenness, about infertility. Also, it is financially draining. There are even some patients that have gone to like 5 different hospitals, home and abroad. They've done several tests. They keep on doing all the tests every time. They give them drugs, they come back and do tests, the woman gets exposed, they do scan for her, she exposes her private parts, the man pays, the man drugs his sperm, he does it through different methods. It is very tiring and financially draining. Depression ensues at times, okay? Then they get withdrawn from social functions, especially naming ceremonies. Even when there is housewarming, even if there is a wedding, they say, I'm not going. If I go now, you know that feeling as if everybody is looking at you. Or you are feeling you are walking and you are feeling everybody is looking at your wife's abdomen. The woman is feeling like everybody is looking at my tummy. And it's so bad when it's time for prayers and you are not praying. They're like, oh, so she's not even pregnant. She's even menstruating. You are like, all eyes are on you. That is actually very, very depressing, okay? So they withdraw from social ceremonies. Loss of libido. The man starts thinking, oh God, I've been playing all this while now. I'm not scoring. I'm just shooting blanks. That's even for a man that believes that he's not the problem. Most people in this part of the world feels the woman is the issue. So let's even talk about a man that feels, oh, where is the problem? He doesn't even want to have sex again. Have you been having sex every time? When you are ovulating, I have sex with you. When you are not ovulating, I have sex with you. And I know I ejaculate. I have erection, I ejaculate. And you two, you are there. You tell me you are ovulating. You have checked with ovulation strip. You have done scan. The doctor says, yes, you can have sex tonight. You have the symptoms of ovulation. So you just get tired. You get what we call disinterested. You become so neutral, indifferent. Unfortunately, at times, it's those sex that you don't think will make you get pregnant, that we don't think will make you impregnate your wife, that can actually lead to conception. But most people don't know. Because even during the sex, your mind is not there. You are not even enjoying the act of sex anymore. Your sex, your sexual activity, your sexual intercourse is now geared toward you want to get pregnant. So you start seeing, oh, the man is saying, let me dig well. Let me just use that word. Or the woman says, oh, let me be very active. Maybe that's how the baby will stay. So at times they just get tired. Our clients come and you ask them, how many times are you having sex? They will say once in a month. Or they will say, oh, my husband is in Abuja. I'm working in Port Harcourt. How can your sex be three times in a week? Like I mentioned, at least three times in a week. So the loss of libido is a very great problem and it's part of the struggles. Rude comments from families and friends. You know, I mentioned it earlier. I was talking about the struggles. Thank you. Loss of interest in work. Absential at work because of hospital appointments that can lead to loss of job. We have issues, oh, we tell the woman. There are some men that are even very wonderful set of people. They follow their wife everywhere. They just don't leave the burden to her. She comes to a clinic where there are 100 people. When she gets to the hospital at 8 a.m., she doesn't get attended to until 4 p.m. Some of the men follow them, and that's very impressive. But some don't. The woman even has to take excuses like 4 times in a month from her employer. That's embarrassing. The man, if he needs to come to produce a sperm or come and do some certain test, he too needs to take excuse from his employer if he's not employer, if he's not self-employed. So even the absence period at work can even make the employer say, well, go and sort your problem, please. When you finish, you can come back and take your work. Obviously, we know the work will not be available anymore. So the struggles are a lot, okay? Now, there's dwindling love among spouses. Of course, we know and we say that marriage is not all about having children, okay? We say it, that marriage is about having companionship. But we all know, too, that it's all about it. Having children is inclusive. Okay, Allah has said that marriage is for you to have compassion, to love yourself. He has put love between you. We even know the stories of the prophets. We know the time Ibrahim got Ismail before he got Isaac from Sarah, from Sarah, from Hajarat. We know even Mary before he could even bear Isa, Jesus, as her son. You know? We know the stories of all these people that didn't even get pregnant until old age. So even we know that compassion, companionship is part of marriage, but we know that the fruit of the womb is something every couple desires, okay? Increased rate of separation. People are just tired. They've been together. Some don't even wait 2 years. They're like, she's not getting pregnant. Please go. It's so bad that some people go and do evil things. They will say, no, we have gone to look at it. They've gone to a soothsayer. They said, we cannot be together. We cannot have children together. Everybody should part ways. It has led to separation. It has led to divorce. Marital disharmony first. The thing keeps on aggravating, okay? People are going to seek diabolical means. Some will go and, when you watch those Nollywood movies, those things happen. That's why they stage them in films. They will say, Molo Toro, Molo Weshu. They've gone to Satan to beg for children. They will not give them terms and conditions. Oh, when you have this child, at the age of 20, she will die, we will die. People have gone to the extremes. People have gone naked, bathing in the open environment to have babies. People have slept with babalawos, with traditional worshippers, who I don't know what to call them, to get pregnant. People have slept with clerics to get pregnant. You know, people get bamboozled when they are really, really in need of something, okay? It has increased the rate of picking. Some women, they've gone to one bush. One woman has stolen a baby from her hospital. She calls herself a midwife in a urban home. A woman delivers, she tells the woman that your baby is dead. She carries the baby and goes and sell. Severe emotional sequelae. The severity is only known to the people affected. And that's a lot. So these are just few of the struggles. If you start asking people of their experience, you will know that these are just a few. I was talking about the struggles. Thank you. Loss of interest in work, absential at work because of hospital appointments that can lead to loss of job. We have issues, we tell the woman. There are some men that are even very wonderful set of people. They follow their wife everywhere. They just don't leave the burden to her. She comes to a clinic where there are 100 people. When she gets to the hospital at 8 a.m., she doesn't get attended to until 4 p.m. Some of the men follow them, and that's very impressive. But some don't. The woman even has to take excuses like 4 times in a month from her employer. That's embarrassing. The man, if he needs to come to produce his sperm or come and do some certain tests, he too needs to take excuse from his employer if he's not self-employed. So even the absence period at work can even make the employer say, well, go and sort your problem, please. When you finish, you can come back and take your work. Obviously, we know the work will not be available anymore. So the struggles are a lot, okay? Now, there's dwindling love among spouses. Of course, we know and we say that marriage is not all about having children, okay? We say it, that marriage is about having companionship. But we all know too that it's all about it. Having children is inclusive, okay? Allah has said that marriage is for you to have compassion, to love yourself. He has put love between you. We even know the stories of the prophets. We know the time Ibrahim got Ismail before he got Isaac from Sarah, from Sarah, from Hajarat. We know even Mary, before he could even bear Isa, Jesus, as her son. You know, we know the stories of all these people that didn't even get pregnant until old age. So even we know that compassion, companionship is part of marriage. But we know that the fruit of the womb is something every couple desires, okay? Increased rate of separation. People are just tired, they've been together. Some don't even wait 2 years. They're like, she's not getting pregnant, please go. It's so bad that some people go and do evil things. They will say, no, we have gone to look at it. They've gone to a soothsayer. They said, we cannot be together. We cannot have children together. Everybody should part ways. It has led to separation. It has led to divorce. Marital disharmony first. The thing keeps on aggravating, okay? People have gone to seek diabolical means. Some will go and, when you watch those Nollywood movies, those things happen. That's why they stage them in films. They will say, Molo Toro, Molo Weshu. They've gone to Satan to beg for children. They will not give them terms and conditions. oh, when you have this child at the age of 20, she will die, he will die. People have gone to the extremes. People have gone naked, bathing in the open environment to have babies. People have slept with babalawos, with traditional worshippers, who I don't know what to call them, to get pregnant. People have slept with clerics to get pregnant. You know, people get bamboozled when they are really, really in need of something, okay? It has increased the rate of picking. Some women, all of a sudden, they've gone to one bush. One woman has stolen a baby from her hospital. She calls herself a midwife in an urban home. A woman delivers, she tells the woman that your baby is dead. She carries the baby and goes and sell. Severe emotional sequelae. The severity is only known to the people affected. And that's a lot. So these are just few of the struggles. If you start asking people of their experience, you will know that these are just a few. You can see the man and woman worried, looking at the pregnancy test strip. Oh God, it is negative again. I'm not pregnant. The worries are every time. So dealing with the struggles. Yeah, I also finish. Dealing with the struggles. What's the approach to infertility? How do we treat infertility? First thing first, you need to stay together. You need to stay together. It is very important. Don't allow a third party to come and contaminate your union. That third party could be anybody. It could be your boss at work. It could be your frenemies. Person you actually call your friend, but it's actually your enemy. It could be your sister, it could be your brother, it could be your mother, it could be your father. When two people have joined together, have been joined together, that bond has to be there. They normally say it's for better or for worse. Okay? It is a very important point because when the struggles are much, people get so, so weakened that they get so porous. They get so susceptible to a lot of things that are bad, ranging from bad influence and the rest. So staying together in this midst of struggles is very important. Sit your husband down. Sit your wife down. Darling, sweetheart, this is our own trial from Allah. Let us talk about it. I know the man has options. He can marry if he's a Muslim. He can marry more than one wife. Even if he's not a Muslim, people do side chicks. People do side runs. We've seen people that is on their burial that they would now bring some three children saying, ah, see, oh, these are his children, no. And everybody is in shock. I don't want to start mentioning the names of important degrees that are gone, that we know DNA paternity issues were all out there. Sit your spouse down and talk about it. Don't whine all day. Don't transfer aggression. I know it is not easy. I know it is easier said than done. But a family, a couple that talk, that sit together, will be able to face their challenge better. It's like a teamwork. Together, everybody will achieve more. Oh, this is what I feel. This is what you feel. How can we meet at a point? Because it takes two of us to be able to have nice children, to be able to have happy children, okay? So I said, do not allow a third party to come and contaminate your union. It's very, very important, okay? That's what I mean by saying being a formidable couple, okay? Not giving a third party a leeway. Because don't allow people to just come infringe into your family and say, ah, she's not pregnant. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm bringing somebody from the village for you. I know she's this one is very prolific. She's like a pig. And you see a mother bringing a woman, a village girl, and say, well, she's even very respectable. She has manners. She can cook. Yeah, 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 yeah. Come and start saying. The woman can't talk. So you as a man, stay with your wife. You as a woman, if your husband is the one that have issues, stay with your man. Talk about it. First and foremost that I should have mentioned is put your trust in God. Put your trust in Allah because total hope is in God. It is not about money. It's not even about having good doctors, good gynecologists, good urologists. It's about, first of all, put your trust in Allah. Allah is going to answer your prayers. He answered Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam. He gave Mary a child that became an anointed prophet. He gave Sarah a child. He gave Hajarat a child. So yours will come. Don't ever lose hope. It's normal for you to say, ah, now I'm 45. How can I even get pregnant again? I've been trying. We spent money. I've gone on Hajj 5 times. I've done tawaf because of infertility. We have paid imams to pray for us. I've been taking a lot of herbal concoction. I've been taking prophetic medicine. I have done all what the doctors have said I should do. We have even done in vitro fertilization, IVF. Why is God punishing us? There are always trials. God has never said we will not be tried. I mean, we will undergo trials. But he also told us that he will not place a burden on us other than that which we can bear. Likely, if Allah will not sign La Wusa, that he will not place a burden on us other than that which we can bear. So we must always put our hope, our trust in Allah. Wa ma yataki laha ya jihalahu makrajan. Allah is indeed sufficient for he. Allah is indeed sufficient for her that puts her trust in Allah. Okay? Now, dealing with the struggles, you consult your doctor for appropriate diagnosis and prompt management. Our people are fond of going to Ilialago. Oh, this person took this herbal concussion. They went to Ilorin. They went to Iwo. They went to anywhere they go to, etc. And they gave them this concussion. Immediately, she took it. She became pregnant. Oh, they said they will flush something from her vagina, that something is blocking it. Some evil forces have blocked her womb. You know, there's what they call Edda. They will say, ha, she has Edda. Or she even has a genie that is sleeping with her. That's why she's not getting pregnant. That's why the sperm of her husband is washing away. Consult your doctor, your family physician, your gynecologist, your urologist, as the case may be. And even if your case has gotten to the level of you have to have what we call a multidisciplinary approach, for instance, the person has diabetes, has hypertension, has some endocrine disorders, they might need to see a gastroenterologist and endocrinologist. Even if it means she's having issues or she's having issues, they might need to see a psychologist. It gets to that level at times, okay? So management is on an individualized basis with the respect to the causes of couples infertility. Like I mentioned, I don't want to start saying, yo, what we call HSD, people that are close to people that have been investigated for infertility, right? So scan, blood test, scan, and all those things. So it is when all these tests have been done, the doctor have examined you, have checked you, asked you questions, has synchronized all the info together. That's when you can say this is what the solution can be. The doctor will prefer a particular fertility treatment for you. Don't patronize quacks. I need to mention this. There are so many supplements being sold. I don't want to mention them so that I won't be doing the marketing for these people that have this brand. They will say this supplement is very good. It will make you get pregnant. It will boost your... Just consult your doctor first. I have seen patients spend over $500,000 on drugs meant to I don't know what to call it now. They will promise them heaven and hell with those drugs. So the patient will continue to buy. God, you've not bought enough. Buy it. That's 6 months, 1 year. The patient is still spending money. Is it not even better you go and do cooperative? Because they will keep on giving you hope. Buy more, buy more. And nothing is happening. Be careful of quacks, okay? Do what your doctor has recommended for you. It's very, very important. Synchronize always with your family physician. I've said that. Your gynecologist, your urologist, other specialists as needed. Even psychologists if needed. Because some women, some men, they just lose it. The self-esteem is gone. The efficiency is reduced. They are in and out of depression. They start having what we call bipolar disorder. They will be happy today, they will be angry tomorrow. They will transfer aggression. Some doctor shopping. I need to stress this. We have our clients, our patients that would have gone to 10 different hospitals. I know it is not easy. I know it is in a bid to get solution. It is actually not easy. But really, it is not worth it. It is not a case of you want to go and buy pepper or you want to go and buy tomato at my 12 markets. That person is capable. I know it is not easy, especially for people that have gone to the extent of things like in vitro fertilization, what we call IVF, test tube babies. You know, you do it in one center, it wasn't successful, or you go to another center, hoping it to be successful, it's not so. I know people that have done IVF 6 times. That is the 7th time that you became successful. And I know people that did IVF once and it became successful. And I know people that during the course of IVF, they got pregnant on their home. This tells you that there is always hope. But doctor shopping, you alone, you have gone to 20 doctors, that is out of it. And at times you even get tired, you feel as if these doctors are just using you for experiments. It gets to that level at times. And all those money you spend are not refundable. Once you get to this one, they will say you pay this. When you go to another one, you do the test again. I know it's not easy. It's all in a bid to get solution, okay? Avoid self-medication. This is very important, especially for the ladies. They will tell you you have fibroid, you need to get it operated. You will not go somewhere that they say they will give you something to insert in your private part. You insert that thing in your private part and you have what we call stenosis. The whole place will plaster together because that thing is porosity. You can't even have sex anymore, let alone saying you want to get pregnant. They will tell you, take this drug if you take your fibroid away. You spend $1 million on it and yet the fibroids are still there. It happens to a lot of ladies. Some, it's so bad that the corrosion that happens, we spoil the private area of the woman and we need to even do plastic surgery for her. So let us avoid self-medication. So, thanks for listening. Different languages. Thank you, Mercy. Thank you. We await questions.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Rabiu. So I'll just jump straight into the questions.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, perfect. Is it advisable that a new couple try to delay getting pregnant very soon after nikah, probably to get convenient and
Is it advisable?
Is it advisable for adding to the family? Will that affect fertility?
Okay. Should I go ahead or
will yes, please answer like before, to... but you deal with the question okay. And I will ask the next. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for asking that question. Now, people have their various desires, what they want, what they've planned. Okay. Now, if you are marrying at the age of 20, 22, and you want to delay it when you are 25, that's still fair enough. But if you are getting married at 35, 36, and you are saying you want to delay, it is a no-no. Now, we have couples that they are like, no, for the first 2 years of our marriage, we want to enjoy ourselves. We want to travel, tour the whole world, enjoy ourselves before we start thinking of any baby. But the best reproductive age is actually from age 18, okay, to something like 35. So whatever thing you are thinking of doing at that time, let it be within that range. Now, the world has gone so advanced that we've seen women that they say, wow, they are busy with their work. They don't want to get pregnant now. They are going to extract their eggs from them. They will retrieve their eggs and go and freeze it. We have that being done now. So when I'm ready to now get pregnant, I'll go and get my frozen eggs. There are some ethical issues with that because some have said, oh, so the woman just wants to play about when she's 45 because she has some eggs stored somewhere. So straight to the question, they have the right to do what they so desire, But they need to be careful too, because the window, optimizing window period for a woman is very short. For the men, it's better. But for the woman, her eggs are best efficient when she's less than 35. So if you are ready for marriage, you want to rest for 1 year, fine. But you can as well do some investigations with your doctor. Let your doctor say your husband is fine, your wife is fine. You can delay for 6 months or more. But just don't do it without any medical guidance. That might be dangerous. I hope I've answered that. Thank you.
Thank you. For how long should a couple wait before they seek doctor's attention for infertility?
Thank you very much. From the definition, I said 1 year, that's 12 months. But there's a caveat, there are some exceptions to this. If by the time a woman is getting married, she's already 35, that woman will not wait for 1 year before she seeks help. Like I told you, the woman's egg is less efficient above 35 years of age. So she's getting married at 35. She's not that kind of woman that will wait 1 year before she seeks advice. A woman, a man having medical conditions such as diabetes, the woman has been told she has what we call anovulation, she's not ovulating. She has what we call endometriosis. She has done a surgery in the past. Maybe she had fibroid or she had ectopy and she's now married. That kind of woman is not going to wait for 12 months. So clearly stated, anybody below 35 years and does not have any issue with the husband, with the wife before, they can wait for 1 year. But if at any point in time there is a K-leg, she's above 35, for the man, usually the age is not much of a big deal. Man can marry at 40, he can marry at 45, he can marry at 50. But for the woman specifically, but if the man is somebody that has diabetes, that has some funny, some medical condition, they will not wait for 1 year. In fact, immediately they get married, they will need to start going for consultation for prompt diagnosis and adequate management. That has answered that question.
Thank you. The next question is two parts. So the first, I'll read both of them. Is there any particular method that allows the couple to determine the sex of the baby? That's the first. The second, okay. Is it advisable or safe for a woman to continue childbearing at age 45, even after 3 children?
Okay, thank you very much, Mariam. Yeah, that one is a big one. The first question, sex of the baby. And you see, when I started my lecture, I made sure I quoted from Quran 42, Surah Ash-Shura, verses 49 to 50. Even no matter what we do, Allah has destined that some will have females, daughters. Some will have sons. Some will not have sons. Some will not have daughters. In fact, we can't add to the Quran. You know they are hermaphrodites. They are actually children that are born with ambiguous genitalia. They are not females, they are not males. They are both genders. Now, particular method, you read some things, they will say, when you have sex on this particular day, it's likely to be a male. When you have sex on this particular day, it's likely to be a female. Some of the time, those things work. In fact, if it's IVF that person is going for, there's what we call gender balancing. We don't call it sex selection anymore. Because if you call it sex selection, that means we are creating a bias to the whole world. There are even too many women already. And some now want men, they want boys. So there's a way they do some, what we call pre-genetic counseling and some analysis to choose. And we usually use that for maybe when there are some medical conditions. Maybe the man is AS, the woman is AS. They want to make sure they are not transferring a baby that's going to be a sickler. So they'll use that method to find the sex. And if they are lucky, they will tell them, okay, we want females, we want males. But when it comes to natural conception, there are some few ways we tell patients. That's why it's important to liaise with your doctor. Okay, let's try this way. meet your wife this day, have sex this day, we might be lucky. But none of it is 100% assuring, okay? The one that is like 98, 99% is the one that is done through IVF procedures. You understand? But not everybody has money because of that. And I know that problem is a lot. We must not lie. While some are still looking for babies, some are saying they want girls. Some are saying they want boys. So answer to the question is, there are some ways, but it is not that. It is 100% guaranteed. The one that is up to 98, 99% guaranteed is the one through IVF. But again, talk to your gynecologist. They will tell you some few tidbits. The second question about bearing children above the age of 45, okay? Like I told you, the best age is when the woman is less than 35. I don't know, I need to mention this. You should know that there are some children we call children with Down syndrome. The Yoruba will call them omojidirin. I don't know how to say that. Like those children are not behaving normal like any other child. They won't walk when they are supposed to walk. They won't sit, they won't stand. Their mental alertness is very low. When they go to school, they can't really make it. They can't catch along with other children. The risk of congenital anomalies, that's what I should call it, increases with increasing age. I am not saying a woman that delivers at 40 will definitely have a child with Down syndrome, but I'm telling you that the risk is higher when the woman is above 35. So if you are above 45 and you still want to give birth to your child, it is your choice, I must not lie, but you need to consult your doctor, consult your gynecologist for best options, because people have their certain issues. For the woman that is 45 and wants to give birth, there must be a reason. I don't know. People have their own different reasons for things. So, but in truth, medically, telling you the truth, it is dangerous. We are not even talking about women that have had cesarean sections, three cesarean sections before they still want to give birth for the fourth, for the fifth child. I mean, we are even talking about the quality of the eggs. Is it worth it to have a child that you will even wish the child was not alive eventually? So everything is synchronizing with your gynecologist for best options available. We've seen people that delivered at the age of 50 and there was nothing wrong. We've seen people that delivered at the age of 34 and their child has cerebral palsy, had Down syndrome. We've seen babies with no heart, hole in the heart. We've seen babies with big head. We've seen babies with limbs abnormalities, okay? So I've answered that question. Let the patient synchronize with the doctor. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you. There are about 7 questions. I'm not sure we can deal with them all, but I'm going in order. So unfortunately, if we run out of time, I'm sorry, we might not be able to take them. But so the next one is, does the size of the man's genitals have any effect in ability or inability to impregnate?
Okay, thank you very much. The size, we call it penis. At times when we want to do some packaging, we call it penile shaft, okay? I know there's shaft inside our cars, okay? Now, the size of the penis, I don't want to read into the minds of the questioner, but I'm feeling the person will be more worried about maybe the penis being a small size, okay? Usually people with big penile shafts, people with big penis will not be so worried, except if the woman is worried, maybe her own aperture is small for the size of her husband's organ. But for people that have small sized penile shafts, it doesn't mean they cannot have erection. It doesn't mean they cannot ejaculate. So answering the question, you know, the sperms are so many, 20 to 200 million. You just need one or two to be able to fertilize the egg of the woman. So it is not the size we come into play. We are adults here. Nobody is above 20 here, I guess. The size we come into play when it comes to issues of satisfaction with the spouse, with the wife, okay? Or when it comes to the issue of, okay, is the man even getting the joy in sexual intercourse? And that's why we have things that they say penis enlargement. Yeah, buy this thing, rub it, take this. To go to the question, the size of the penis does not necessarily mean the man, if the size is small, does not mean the man cannot impregnate his wife. It is the quality of the sperm that is being produced from the testes of the man that matters. Do you get the two testicles that I described earlier that are in the scrotal sac, in the scrotum? So it is the sperm being produced by those testes that are now being passed out from the penis that is important. So once your penis is straight, it has hole, your sperm can, you know, it's where the sperm comes out that the urine comes out from too. And your sperm can come out from it, you are all well and good. If you now have issues with satisfaction and your wife and all that, you see doctors specially for that. The size of your penis, even if it's small, in as much as it's producing sperm, your testes are undergoing what we call spermatogenesis, production of sperm, and your sperm are tested okay. You can impregnate. Do you know that even if you deposit sperm in between the legs of your woman, we call it interfemoris, you are doing some, what do we call it now, some priest, some cuddling and all those things, some you are sending messengers, and by mistake, your sperm even falls between the thighs of your woman. The sperm, if it's a very solid one with good motility, can go up. That's why they will say some people said, oh, she's a virgin, oh, and she got pregnant. It's possible. We call it interfemoris. The man is dancing the penis in between the legs, and the sperm comes out, and the woman is saying, yeah, I should not get pregnant, and she got pregnant. That sperm was a very solid sperm that ran up and became a winner. Do you understand? So I've answered that question.
Thank you. Please comment on seeking a second opinion, especially in a world where we read of so many misdiagnoses.
Okay. Yeah, like I mentioned earlier, it's your right to actually talk to your doctor. At times, we don't get comfortable with certain decisions our doctors tell us. We are all humans, and it's only God that is perfect. My own slogan used to be, or it is, doctor cares, it is God that kills. So even the best of all doctors, when God, Allah, said amen, nobody can stop that amen. But when that amen will come is what we don't know. Now, there's nothing wrong in seeking second opinion. What I stressed is, don't be somebody that will now go to 20 hospitals. What? I don't get it. Do you want to be shareholders in those hospitals? I know out of anxiety, out of, I'm not getting solution. Okay, they recommend this one. Let me try again. Oh, this one trained in US. This one trained in Germany. This one trained in Dubai. Let me try. Oh, let's go to German hospital. You know, you are now the one that has gone to 20 hospitals. They've been giving you several hormonal drugs, the ladies. The lady has been giving so. So you can have second opinion. In fact, such thing gives you a peace of mind. When you hear, okay, two doctors are saying the same thing, then you're like, okay, let's give it. So it's now for you to now choose the one that you trust more. Because actually that trust is important too. If you have a specialist and you doubt that specialist, please leave that specialist. Nobody will kill you for it. So it is a yes for you to have a second opinion. But know that everything is still even in the hands of God. It's God that helps, even the doctors that are helping you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rabia. The next one is, what are the diets that can improve fertility?
Okay.
And let me give you another one that's kind of related to that. Sorry, just because there are so many questions. Yeah. You might as well do some of them together. Are there some certain foods that can improve sperm or egg health? And is it true that it takes up to 3 months to show? So I think you can deal with those two together.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah. Diets that can improve infertility. See, all these things, just Google. You'll see a lot. They will say, take this fruit. The one I can say that you can quote me, you can take a lot of bananas for the men. Banana has a lot of potassium that actually helps sperm. It helps erection. It helps sperm motility. Some of these supplements that people sell, I don't want to start mentioning names so that it will be as if we are doing a sort of consultation here. Some of these supplements actually help, okay? But You are somebody that has been chopping banana for 1 year. Nothing is happening. You still want to continue to eat the bananas? Oh, they've recommended avocado for you. They say it's good. You have been eating it for 1 year. Nothing is happening. Do you still want to sit at a point? No smoking, no alcohol, because all those things can affect sperm production. Thank God we are not the set of people that take all those things. Okay? So the diet normally is have your balanced diet. Have things rich in zinc. Let me just go to that extent. Have things rich in things like vitamin E. Have things rich in folic acid. And all these things we get it from our diet. That's just the truth. Our vegetables, our fruits. So, but all those things are not just enough. You need to see the doctor that will not tell you this is the specific thing, because some of those things are general. Then the food that can improve sperm and egg. I'm back to what I've been saying. For this is good for that. You take all those things. But for instance, take all those foods that they say you've taken. Your tubes are blocked as a woman. You're a woman, you have fallopian tubes, both of them are blocked. No, there is no amount of food that you will take that will open your tubes. For egg quality, there are sometimes we just need to give you drugs. Somebody is not producing eggs. She's not ovulating. She's not even producing the eggs to release. We have to do something exogenously, giving her some injections to help her. So all those things are there. So generally, our balanced diet is okay. Don't let anybody bamboozle you to say, oh, go and use 200,000 naira to buy this, okay? So again, when you consult your doctor, they'll be able to synchronize all your food. They'll tell you it's okay, it's fine. This supplement is okay. There are some herbs that are actually formed in capsules, okay? That at times it works. Now, the question on 3 months, for the men, it actually takes up to that, like some 120 days for the sperm to really, really produce better. In fact, at times we tell people when they want to do their sperm test to abstain from sex for like 3 days. Sorry, for the women, it takes up to like 3 months. Sorry. For the men, it takes some 3 days, 4 days. That's why when they want to even do sperm tests, we tell them to abstain from sex for like 3 days so that we are getting the best concentrated sperm sample after those 3 days of abstinence. So it's true, there is a time for spermatogenesis. There is a duration for sperm production. And that is like some 3 days for men. And for the women, it takes up to like 120 days, okay? Now, when they now say you should take drugs, those drugs cannot just work within 1 week or 2 months. It takes up to a period of 3 months. So there are times you go to your doctor and you say, take these drugs for 3 months, then we repeat your test, then we know what needs to do. All right.
Thank you. Can severe menstrual pain cause infertility?
Okay. That's a very, how do I go to that now? See, what we call menstrual pain, severe menstrual pain, we call it dysmenorrhea. Dysmenorrhea, that's the word we use for it. So many things can cause dysmenorrhea, severe menstrual pain. Menstrual pain on its own can be what we call physiological. That is normal occurrence in a woman. When we're small, when we want to start menstruating, when we start menstruating, they tell us, you become a woman. And as a woman, when you menstruate, you have pain. They will not tell us, oh, when you get married, the pain will disappear. Some of it's true, some of it not true. Now, there's now the one we call pathological. Pathological means it's abnormal. There's a disease condition making that woman have that menstrual pain. Such things include endometriosis, it includes things like cysts, okay? So you need to consult your doctor to know what is causing your own severe menstrual pain. If it is something we need to treat on time before you get married, or if you are married, what we need to do so that it won't affect your fertility. It can actually cause it, because it can cause a lot of inflammation, it can cause blocked tubes, it can cause what we call frozen pelvis, that everywhere will be matted together. So it's a yes, it can cause it, but again, I can't say that is the cause, except when the person has gone to the doctor for assessment. Next question, Mariam.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we have to close.
Fine.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Rabiu. That was really informative. I was going to ask perhaps if you are on any social media platforms where you share any tips or advice, and maybe the attendees can follow you on there. If you're
I am. I'm on YouTube, I'm on Facebook, I'm on Instagram.
Your blog, yes. Yeah. It was So what exactly is the full link for your blog?
Okay, ask Dr. Fab. A-S-K.
Yeah.
A-S-K-D-R-F-A-B.
Okay. All right. So and also I believe you're joining us next weekend as well, next Sunday.
Yeah, 21st, exactly, inshallah. Yeah.
So Dr. Rabiu will be joining us next weekend, inshallah. So make sure you you join that event so that she can pick up any questions that she couldn't address today. And she's kindly shared her, I believe this is her blog. Yes. So ask Dr. Fab. So also make the most of that resource. So may Allah bless you abundantly, Dr. Rabiu, and increase you in knowledge. And for all those who are looking for children, may Allah bless you with the best of children. Ameen. That will be the coolness of your eyes. Thank you so much. Next, inshallah, join us for another benefit session. Thank you.
Inshallah. Wa alaykum salam. Thank you, everybody. Yeah.